The David Feldman radio program is made possible by listeners like you. You sad, pathetic humps.
Well, it's the dog days of summer. All my white liberal friends are exhausted because they don't know how to fight. They're not used to the fight. They want a break from the nonsense in Washington, D.C. So I thought I'd slow things down a little, just something light and fluffy, and talk about Israel's parliament passing a new law that will characterize Israel as principally a Jewish state. Figure this is a light topic, and we'll discuss it with a PhD candidate. He's about 2 weeks away from getting his doctorate. His name is Arnon Degani, and he joins us today from Los Angeles. Hello, Arnon.
Hi, David.
Thank you for joining us. You're a listener to the show, and you wanted to come on and set me straight about Israel.
Yeah. Sometimes your guests, they're all well-intentioned, really, but sometimes the amount of inaccuracies that flies kind of makes me cringe. So
yes.
I'm here to fix that.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Arnon will be a doctor, not a medical doctor to make his mother happy, but a doctor of history from UCLA. You just have to finish up your thesis. And when will it be done?
Yes.
When will it be done?
I'm writing the conclusions right now.
You're writing the conclusions. And I watched some of your lectures on YouTube, and I want to put you in a box so our listeners know who you are. And then you'll educate us about the relationship between the Jews and the Arabs in the West Bank and Gaza, and then the Arabs who live, work, and vote in Israel proper. We'll talk about the history of Israel, and you seem to be a reactionary. By reactionary, I mean you want to return to the vision of the founders of Israel 70 years ago. We're celebrating the 70th anniversary of the founding of Israel. Is that a fair statement, that you think Israel has lost its way and needs to return to its original values?
That is a fair statement, but very much like the U.S., where the original founders had good ideas, they were also implicated in some of the bad things this country was created on, such as slavery.
Right.
I wouldn't say, I just see a lot of sense and a lot of benefit that Israelis could gain from seeking those original, some of these original patterns. And, you know, without being blind to the grave, grave injustices that this generation committed.
Towards the Arabs.
Yes. Towards the Arabs, towards non-Ashkenazi Jews.
Ashkenazi Jews are the European Jews, the Sephardim, or the wandering Jews, the Jews from Morocco, the Jews from Africa. I don't know if they're I don't know if you would call them.
I don't know if they're wandering, but yes, they're from North Africa, from Yemen, from Iraq. But in any case, I am sort of a reactionary by finding sincere, democratic, you could say liberal, bent in early Israel. Of course, without any intentions of saying that it was some sort of utopian, egalitarian society. But those earlier leaders had the good sense of keeping things ambiguous to the point where you could still integrate non-Jewish communities into the Israeli society, which is the opposite of what is happening right now.
This is America, and it's a Manichaean discourse in America. Explain what Manichaean means.
Binary, like it's either this or that. So
yes, and you come from a parliamentary system where it's fluid.
But there is left or and right. I think that in that sense, I belong to the left.
Right. So there's more room for nuance in Israel, and there are 20 sides to every argument. But my listeners, Americans, we see things with no shades of gray.
Right.
So it's like black or white. So let's put you in a box, okay? So my listeners can understand who you are and where you're coming from, what your point of view is, okay? And then you'll explain to us some, you'll teach us, okay?
I'll do my best.
Okay, how old are you?
36.
Where were you born?
Israel.
Where were your parents born?
Israel, Palestine.
Where were their parents born?
A lot of Poland and northern Italy.
The word ghetto comes from Italy, right?
I think so, yeah, from like Renaissance Italy, something like that.
Yeah. People think that blacks in Harlem and Jews in Italy congregated together because they were like-minded, when in fact they were rounded up and placed in a ghetto.
Common historical error, yes.
What's a common historical error?
The congregation of Italian Jews and African Americans.
Right. And the blacks during the Great Migration North were pretty much placed in ghettos. Not officially, but officially. Anyway, that's for another discussion. Practicing Jew or a secular Jew?
I'm secular. I'm militantly secular.
Did you serve in the army?
Yes.
What was your rank?
First sergeant. And yeah, I served in, I was a grunt. I served in the infantry.
In the infantry, and you served in the West Bank?
Yes, a lot of West Bank.
What year?
2000 to 2003.
So, Ariel Sharon.
For part of the time, he was the prime minister, yes.
He was the prime minister. His original name was Schneerson. He changed it. Ariel Sharon, very tough guy, right?
Yeah.
You were there when he pulled the settlements out of Gaza.
And that was 2005. I was out of the army by then.
And you were out of the army before he cleaned up the West Bank and went door to door.
So I was fortunate enough to be in some sort of training course during that particular, the big operation in 2002. I was lucky at the time. I thought it was very unlucky to have missed that. But I have done the standard occupation of Palestine, as is kind of depicted in news. I was there. I was it.
He went door to door in the West Bank. Is it fair to say that he was cleaning out the West Bank and taking the bad actors and placing them in Gaza? Was that Ariel Sharon's plan to divide the occupied lands into good Palestinians and bad Palestinians? Did he take all the troublemakers and put them in Gaza and clean up the West Bank and make it livable for the Palestinians?
No. Not at all. I don't know where to start.
Yes or no is good.
During that time,
you don't have to.
Was, you know, yeah.
Yeah. That's what I thought he was doing. You were stationed in the West Bank.
Yes.
And that's considered occupied territory. It's what the Israelis got in 67 after the war. They took it from Jordan.
Right.
And did you participate in the destruction of homes that belong to terrorists? If somebody blew themselves up in Israel, it was practice at that time to then destroy the homes of the survivors of that family.
I wasn't present in one of those, but it was a standard practice. It had I been called to assist in that, I would not have disobeyed the orders. It's not something that Israel is hiding in terms of as a policy.
Right, but they've stopped doing that.
Have they?
I think so. I think they've...
I'm not sure at all. I know that they're legal. I mean, every time this is suggested, every time then there is some sort of legal recourse to that family, and sometimes it works, but I don't think... I think the destruction of homes of the terrorist family is alive and well.
Okay. When you were serving in the military in the early aughts, there was an epidemic of Palestinian kids blowing themselves up on buses in Israel proper.
Right.
A wall was built.
Right.
It was designed by Ehud Barak.
Partially, yeah.
The wall separates the West Bank from Israel proper.
Yes.
The human rights violations notwithstanding, has the wall worked to pretty much eliminate suicide bombing in Israel?
I think it has helped. I think also a strategic decision by the terrorist organizations to stop that type of attack. And it's announced. It's something that they've decided in the mid-aughts. to refrain or to practice less. And just to be accurate, the wall, the outline of the wall, doesn't neatly separate the West Bank from Israel proper. The wall makes very significant intrusions into the West Bank.
Okay, I understand that, but what I'm asking you is, there was almost this existential crisis that was going on in Israel in the aughts when it came to...
early aughts, it was a tough time, for sure.
Suicide bombs.
Yes.
How do you stop it? And you're crediting Hamas and the Palestinian Authority for no longer funding suicide bombing? You're not saying...
No. But as a military tactic, they realize that it does them harm maybe more than it does any good. And right now, they're refraining. It's sort of like a ceasefire. It's a strategic Palestinian decision.
And you give no credit to the wall. You don't think the wall...
I do give credit to the wall. Because
What percentage of the suicide bombings going down can be attributed to the wall? And what can be attributed to a strategic decision on behalf of the...
I can't answer that. I'm not that kind of...
How easy is it for a Palestinian who wants to blow himself up to sneak across from Gaza or the West Bank? Those are basically the two territories that belong supposedly to the Palestinians. How easy would it be for somebody to strap dynamite to themselves or plastique, sneak across the border and blow themselves up?
Probably not that easy, and probably the wall, because anyone who'd want to do that would need some strategic help, or some logistical help, sorry. You know, the more people that are in on a secret, in on the mission, then the more chances that Israeli intelligence will catch up on them and stop this from happening. And that's why...
I'll get to that in a second. Let's just stay here for a second. This is good. Thank you for... This is valuable. They need help from within Israel for a suicide bombing to be successful, because a terrorist, a Palestinian, cannot sneak across the border wearing plastique or whatever they use. They have to be fitted with it once they arrive in Israel proper. And to refresh my listeners' memories, there are two Palestinian territories in Israel. One is the West Bank and the other is Gaza, and they're not connected. And the West Bank is larger. It's more peaceful right now. It is up against Jordan. There is a wall that separates the West Bank from Israel proper. So you're saying that a Palestinian terrorist who wants to blow himself up on a bus in Jerusalem would need help from somebody within Israel proper?
Not necessarily. I didn't say that. It has happened a few times. Look, again, this isn't... I'm sorry, David. Counterterrorism and how to deal with insurgency and military tactics, that's not my forte, I have to admit.
Okay, I'm getting to a point here. Okay. And your thesis that you're working on.
Okay. Israel, I'll do my best to answer.
Okay. Israel proper.
Right.
How many people live in Israel if you take out the West Bank and Gaza?
I think approximately 9 million.
How many non-Jews, how many Arabs live in Israel proper as citizens?
About 22%, something like that. Yes. Just above 20%.
Have we found that the 22%, those Arab citizens of Israel, serve as a fifth column for Palestinian terrorists? Do they aid and abet suicide bombers in Israel proper?
By and large, no.
Why is that?
That is a great question. That is where I feel like I have the authority to answer that.
That's right. I was building to this.
So the Arabs in Israel, and many of them will now identify as Palestinians who live in Israel, not just Arabs. And many of them will reject the category of being called an Arab Israeli, right? Nevertheless, despite discrimination and despite their solidarity with their brethren in the West Bank, they are Israeli citizens. They're part of Israeli society. There's interaction with them on a daily basis in several cities and several locales. They speak Hebrew. unfortunately, most Israelis don't speak Arabic. They're Israelis.
Do they vote?
To a large extent.
Do they vote?
Of course.
Do they serve in the Knesset, which is the Congress?
Yes, they serve in the Knesset.
Is it conceivable that an Arab who is not Jewish could end up serving as prime minister? Or are there laws on the books preventing?
As days are passing, every day that's passing, it's less and less conceivable. And that's what's problematic about this law.
And what is the law? It was passed by the parliament, so it's officially enacted now?
Yes. Maybe there's some sort of procedure, but it's done.
Right. And so what does the law say?
The law, almost all of its clauses are rather benign, I'd have to admit. It's some sort of, what's the official anthem of the state? What are the official statewide holidays, Jewish holidays? The Hebrew calendar is officially recognized. Stuff that have been the lived reality for everyone living in Israel for the last 7 years.
Okay, so let me stop you there for 1 second, because we study the Constitution, the United States Constitution, on this show. Israel is now officially 70 years old. They don't have a constitution. Like Great Britain, there is no Israeli constitution, right?
Right.
It's a series of laws and norms that dictate the behavior.
Right.
It was never officially a Jewish state. It was kind of a de facto Jewish state, but not a pro forma Jewish state. Does this law make it a pro forma Jewish state?
I'm sorry that I'm constantly trying to tease out the nuance and not go into the binary, but it was officially a Jewish state, and it remains officially a Jewish state.
What do you mean officially?
Well, first of all, like I said, there was a Declaration of Independence. It's a document that has some sort of central gravitas in the culture and even in legal discourse, in Supreme Court decisions. And that officially declares Israel as a Jewish state. It is a norm to consider it a Jewish state. It appears in the symbols. It's everywhere. The reason that there will always be ambiguity of what it means to have a Jewish state, right? I mean, it's not as if you can find some sort of manual given from God about how the Jewish state should behave. By the way, also, Jewish religion is part, I mean, there are aspects of Jewish religiosity that enter into daily life in Israel. If you want to get married, you have to get married with a rabbi. Public transportation is closed on Sabbath. There's a lot of Jewish official aspects to the state that if you combined them together, even before this law, you can say, well, that's a Jewish state.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So this law, more than anything, kind of put in one concise document that was also drafted for the purposes of clarifying to whoever isn't Jewish that this state isn't really yours.
So you're against that?
I'm very much against that.
From what I've seen of your lectures, and I guess this is your thesis, you believe there needs to be some kind of truth and reconciliation, that American Jews and Israeli Jews need to look at their past and take responsibility for the injustices that the nation of Israel has inflicted on the Arabs, the indigenous Arabs who were already living in Palestine, and then the ones who were warehoused in Lebanon, Gaza, and Jordan after Israel declared its independence.
Yeah, I don't see any way this could get significantly better if there isn't some sort of reconciliation and some sort of admitting of wrongdoing and apologizing for it. I'm convinced that is... By the way, apologies are very cheap. I don't think it will cost us that much.
Well, actually, they're not cheap in the Jewish religion. You just don't.
Right, actually. Right.
In all seriousness, you just can't say you're sorry. You have to ask 3 times for forgiveness.
Wow.
Did you know that?
Yeah, I know that.
American Jews and Americans only really get the AIPAC version of Israel. AIPAC is the big Jewish. They're not really a lobby. They are referred to as a lobbyist, but they're really not. But we get the AIPAC version, which is the Likud version of events. And Likud is the far-right wing party in Israel. Bibi Netanyahu is Likud. J Street is a kind of new lobbying group that represents, for lack of a better word, labor, the Labor Party in Israel. Is that fair?
Maybe labor and the party left of that, which is, you know, it would be in the U.S. would be the equivalent of Sanders camp within the Democratic Party, I would guess.
So if you were only pay attention to the conversation in Washington, D.C., you would assume that 99% of Jews in Israel are tough on Iran, tough on the Palestinians, and want a military surveillance state in Israel, that they're right wing. But that's not true. It's 50-50. Israel is moving more to the right, but there's an actual conversation going on in Israel about the Palestinians and Iran that Congress here in the United States is not having.
Yes. I wish it was 50-50. I think the right wing is very much dominant right now. The undemocratic right wing, the one that passed this law, is very much dominant.
15 years ago, there was room for nuance. Ariel Sharon, who was Likud, and he was, as I understood it, the toughest Jew. I mean, one of the most despised military heroes. The liberal Jews hated Ariel Sharon, but before he went into a coma, he was moving to the left. He had created his own party, pulled out of Gaza, and may have ended up doing what Rabin had wanted, right?
Gaza Strip, he cleared Gaza Strip from every single Jew living there. That's something that a lot of left-wingers could not have done.
It was his Nixon go to China move.
Maybe. Yeah. Except, this isn't just a diplomatic maneuver. People's houses were demolished. This is a big deal.
Jewish houses were demolished. Yeah.
The way he saw it is that, you know, it's cutting one leg to keep the rest of the body healthy or whatever. I think he had a lot of predatory ambitions But anyways, he coveted a lot of the land in the West Bank, and he thought that the better way to consolidate Israel's control over the most of the West Bank is possible if we gave up Gaza. Because Gaza, let me tell you something about Gaza, just a small anecdote. Gaza, before Israel pulled out, had 1.25 million Palestinians and had 9,000 Jews. So that's less than 1% of Jews inside this one territorial unit. How much land did Jews control in the Gaza Strip?
I don't know.
22%. The Jewish settlements in the West Bank that had 9,000 residents in them at most controlled roughly more than 20% of the entire landmass of the Gaza Strip. So the injustice, the problematic status quo in Gaza was much more striking than maybe the West Bank. And so it was kind of obvious that's unsustainable. Mm-hmm. I think Israeli control in the West Bank is unsustainable, but maybe it's easier to manage for a few years. But Gaza Strip was it was a joke.
Mm-hmm. Do you think there should be a two-state solution, or do you think that there should just be a state of Palestine that includes Gaza and the West Bank, and the Israeli Jews become a minority eventually?
I think I don't have to be honest. I don't really know what's the best move forward. I don't have this kind of 12-point plan roadmap of how to make the situation better. I do think that allowing Palestinians self-sovereignty in the form of an independent state as a transition phase for when Israelis and Palestinians, Jews and Arabs, can maybe overcome a lot of the bad blood in the last 100 years, and then we can talk about some sort of federative solution, mutual recognition of rights in each territory, and perhaps maybe one democratic state at the end that's binational or follows a binational principle of being both Jewish and Palestinian.
Okay. Let me ask you a gut question. And this is unfair, but let me ask you a question that Americans would respond to. Mm-hmm. Did the Palestinians lose World War II? Forget the War of Independence 70 years ago. Did the Palestinians lose World War II? Did the Mufti side with Hitler? Was he aware of the concentration camps?
Maybe. I don't know. Look, the Mufti sided with Hitler, full stop.
The question I'm asking, I this sounds very aggressive, and I apologize.
Right.
But did the Palestinians lose World War II? Did they pick the wrong side during World War II? Did they side with Hitler? Did they assist Hitler?
In as much as they is the Mufti, then yes. It did not benefit the Palestinian national movement to pick the losing side and the one that was committing mass genocide at that.
Should there be consequences to picking the wrong side during World War II?
Well, whether or not there should be or there shouldn't, I think there was. That's a fact. I think the fact that, you know, the British controlled Palestine at the time, Israel-Palestine.
Do we know what would have happened had Hitler won? What would have happened to the Jews in Palestine had Hitler won?
As a historian, I'm not supposed to play these games, but I can tell you it's probably not good things.
Not good things.
Yeah. You are pointing out facts. The Mufti fled, met with Hitler, I think helped him with Bosnian Muslim soldiers that collaborated with the Nazis. That is a fact. The fact that there was not a lot of love between the Palestinian National Movement and the British Empire, which was fighting Hitler at the time, and so that created some sort of confluence of interest between Nazi Germany and the Palestinians, that is also a fact. To go and say that basically World War II was fought, on the one hand, it was the Allies, and on the other hand, it was the Axis, which was Germany, Italy, Japan, and the Palestinians, which is starting to be the right-wing narrative here, as if the Palestinians have some sort of direct responsibility for the annihilation of European Jewry. That is ahistorical. It's Holocaust denying.
We don't even do it to the Germans. We don't apply collective guilt to the German people for the Holocaust.
Yeah, okay. Exactly.
So you can't apply collective guilt to the Palestinians. Yeah. But as an American,
especially when such guilt is uncalled for.
Okay. As an American, and I'm filtering it through the lens of, you know, we're a militaristic country and we fight wars all the time.
Wonder how that's like.
Yeah. The difference is Israeli wars have a beginning, middle, and an end.
Really?
You have operations and Israel is not at war with Lebanon right now. It's not at war with Syria. It's not at war with Egypt. It's not at war with Jordan. It's not at war with Saudi Arabia. It's not at war with Iraq. These are countries that Israel fought wars with, and they're over. They have stopped.
But we are fighting the 48 war. This is still...
Okay. But those wars ended.
That war, the 48 war, sometimes it goes on a hiatus, but...
Right, but it is a myth to say that Israel is in a constant state of war with its neighbors. It's not. It's not at war with Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia won't admit it, but they're pretty much on the same side when it comes to Iran.
I mean, again, I'm sorry to always be pulling things out of the historian's hat, but Israel, for instance, fought Lebanon in 82, mm-hmm. and then withdrew completely from Lebanon only in 2000 when we realized it took 18 years to realize how stupid it is to stay in the territory that you've been dealing with an enemy from, and thinking you can manage that territory in a way that would fit your interests. And soldiers came in body bags, a few every week, until Israel realized it just makes no sense to have perpetual war for 18 years. So, I mean, our wars also drag.
Well, but then again, with Lebanon, is Lebanon a country or a collection of nation states? I mean, you have Nasrallah, who is Hezbollah. He's taken over territory in Lebanon. So, I mean, Lebanon has been fractured by civil war. And was Israel fighting a war against Lebanon proper? Or was it at one time fighting a war against the Palestinians who were living there?
Right.
Then were they fighting a war against Hezbollah, which is stationed there? Those are foreign actors who have set up shop in Lebanon.
It's very similar, though. We're not here to fight the Iraqi people. We're here to fight the terrorists. They're kind of the same.
Okay.
And again, there are two. There's two wars in Lebanon. The first, the second Lebanese war did take around a summer to fight. That was it. The first one, you could say that it took 18 years.
Okay. My question about the Palestinians is, everybody who has fought a war with Israel has signed some kind of truce and has sort of recognized them as a nation. Sort of. I don't know how many. I don't know if Saudi Arabia and Egypt and Jordan have recognized Israel's right to exist, but they're not questioning it. Has the Palestinian leadership recognized Israel's right to exist? Not necessarily as a Jewish state, but just a right to exist.
Yes, that's, I mean, on the declarative level, for sure. I think the moment that as historians of the conflict, we kind of point out, it would be 1988 when Yasser Arafat declared, it was a symbolic declaration, but declared an independent Palestinian state over the territories in congruence with 242 and 383.
These are UN resolutions.
UN resolutions. And these UN resolutions, the language within them, of course, recognizes Israel. As you can say, from that moment on, the PLO, in order to be an actor in the world diplomatic scene, recognized Israel's right to exist. And then there were bilateral accords signed in which the PLO was at the time the official representative of the Palestinian people. Now we have Hamas. It's different. But at the time,
well, you're confusing. Hang on for one second. You're confusing people. The PLO was Yasser Arafat's military arm. He had a political arm called Fatah.
Whoa. Cringe. No. The PLO, you could say, was the Palestinian government in exile. It was the umbrella organization of a lot of different Palestinian organizations. The biggest one of them was Fatah.
And when Yasser Arafat, who was traveling around Tunisia, then he was in Lebanon, he was in Jordan, when he finally settled in Ramallah, his political arm was Fatah, correct?
No. Fatah is a organization with its own institutions and its own militant arm that is part of the PLO.
Okay.
The PLO is an umbrella organization. The Fatah, if you will, is a party within the Palestinian parliament.
Okay, but after the Camp David Accords, Arafat set up shop in Ramallah. They established
Oslo.
The Oslo Accords, I'm sorry. And they created the Palestinian Authority, the PA.
Right.
And kind of like a Palestinian parliament.
Right.
And Yasser Arafat was the president of the Palestinian
of the Authority.
And I always assumed that Fatah was a party within that authority that he identified with. I don't think anybody from the PLO was ever on the ballot.
No. Of course there were.
There were PLO.
The PLO and the Palestinian Authority were essentially, there's a lot of administrative issues here, but essentially Palestinian Authority was the sovereign embodiment of the PLO.
Okay. So it would be like one party rule with splinter groups within the party voting.
No, there were other parties. There's different fronts that were usually more to the left of Fatah in terms of Marxist worldview. And
now Hamas.
Right.
Hamas. That was first a military or a terrorist organization, depending on which side you're on. And then eventually Hamas became a political wing. Is that fair?
I think Hamas always had the duality and from its inception. And Hamas refers to political organizations within the Middle East that follow the Muslim Brotherhood.
From Egypt.
Yes, that began in Egypt. And these are, I would say, religious nationals, right? These are people that they're not Al-Qaeda or ISIS in their doctrine, in the sense that they don't recognize the borders between the different...
Well, the Muslim Islamic Brotherhood comes from Qutb, the Egyptian philosopher from the 50s, the 60s, and the 70s, and Osama bin Laden was an adherent originally of the Muslim Brotherhood. And
yeah.
Dr. Alawari, the guy he shacked up with in Afghanistan and then Pakistan, they came to us via the Muslim Brotherhood, right?
Definitely, there's an intellectual heritage there. But, you know, these were also organizations that were created in certain Cold War contexts.
Hamas would have the same intellectual heritage as Al-Qaeda.
Except Hamas is a firm. If you look at the prime minister of the person leading Gaza today, he has on his jacket, he sometimes has the Palestinian flag. This is something you wouldn't find from an Al-Qaeda operative or ISIS, who really have no regard for the borders between the different Arab Muslim states.
Because so, there's now a truce between Hamas and the PLO. There was a civil war that broke, isn't there?
Things are not good between these two sides. So as you know, Hamas is controlling Gaza Strip. The PLO authority controls the West Bank. And currently, the government of the West Bank is sanctioning Hamas in Gaza.
They had a truce. There were elections held, I don't know, 15 years ago?
2006.
Yeah, 2006 elections were held in Gaza. Hamas won. And Israel, the United States, and the Palestinian Authority in the West Bank refused to recognize Hamas as the party in charge of Gaza.
So there was an election. It was an election for the parliament, not for the president, for the role of the president that remained someone from the Fatah, from traditionally PLO. The election itself was a huge concession by Hamas to the PLO, because the entire mechanism of election and the entire mechanism of the Palestinian Authority has been created through bilateral agreements with Israel that recognize Israel. So in some sort of way, Hamas was recognizing Israel by participating in this election. They won the majority in the parliament, not the presidency. And then some confluence of clashes, local powers in the Gaza Strip, that led to a coup where the Palestinian Authority no longer had any direct control over the mechanisms of government in Gaza Strip, and Hamas and its organization and its military ring and its political wing basically took over and created some sort of statelet in Gaza. Now, Israel, it's a reality. It doesn't really matter if Israel recognizes Hamas or doesn't recognize Hamas. When it's convenient, it definitely recognizes Hamas when there's an airstrike that has a lot of collateral damage. Then you say, well, you know, Hamas governs this area, and who's the person responsible is Hamas. So there's no recognition of Hamas as a negotiating partner, if you call negotiation sitting next to a table. But it is definitely a negotiating partner when the negotiations is done with bombs and airplanes and military incursions.
Gaza, I mean, this, I'm not trying to be insulting. It's a cesspool. I think like 80% of the people there don't have potable drinking water.
It's not doing well, for sure.
Is it a surveillance state? Do the Israelis monitor all the phones in Gaza? Do they know who all the actors are in Gaza?
It is fair to say that after 2005, the main landlord in the Gaza Strip is the Hamas. That is, I think, a fair assessment. Israel controls the airspace, the sea port, the sea access, most of the land borders. The part of the border that's controlled by Egypt is also closed on behest of Israel, you know, because of agreements between Egypt and Israel. So Israel effectively controls the Gaza.
If you are a member of Hamas and you want to go to the Palestinian Authority, I would assume their parliament is in Ramallah. It would be in the West Bank, right?
Right.
How would you get there if you were a...
No, you could not. You could not by any easy means. You might be able, like, you know, to go through Egypt, then through Jordan.
So if I'm a Hamas representative to the Palestinian Authority, how do I speak up? How do I get my message across to the Palestinian leadership in the West Bank?
Right now, the parliament is, you know, it might as well be defunct. I mean,
there is
the coup in the Gaza Strip. There hasn't been an election. An election is past due.
But is there a parliament in the West Bank? Do we have Don't we have Abu Abu Mazen?
There is a parliament in the West Bank that of the Palestinian Authority. But it's, you know, if Israel controls the outskirts of Gaza Strip, and essentially determines what happens there, not in the minute detail, but in the general.
Abu Mazen is the leader of the Palestinians, correct?
He's you know, Hamas would argue with that, but Abu Mazen is the chairman of the PLO and the president of the Palestinian Authority.
And so when you live in the West Bank and you're a Palestinian, you have a problem with the garbage getting collected. You don't go to Israel. You go to Abu Mazen.
Essentially, not, I mean, I would say maybe, I don't know, 90, maybe more percent of the Palestinians are in some sort of at least civic control of the Palestinian Authority, because it was ceded away from the Israeli army that controlled these territories.
The people, the Palestinians who live in the West Bank.
Yes.
Is it fair to say that they're terrified of the Palestinians who live in Hamas, who live in Gaza?
Well, I mean, there are quite a few Hamas supporters in the West Bank there.
But so, they don't want the same fate as Gaza.
I don't think anyone would want, but...
If you're a Palestinian living in the West Bank, can you run a business? Can you call the police?
I don't mind answering these questions, but I'm not a Palestinian. And so I think your listeners...
But you served in the military...
Yeah, so that even makes me less qualified to speak about Palestinian suffering as someone who is partially responsible for it. So I just want to kind of, you know, get away the positionality. I'm an Israeli. I served in the army. I am an Israeli patriot. I can even say that I'm a Zionist. And so any sort of interpretation of what Palestinians want, need, I think it's almost unfair and should be understood as being voiced by who I am.
Right.
So I just have to say that. I don't want to... Look, I'm in academia, and these things are very important.
I'm not arguing with you. I'm interrupting you because I'm trying to paint the picture, the situation.
I'm trying to help, but...
Yeah, you're fantastic. And this is probably the only opportunity for most of my listeners to have the geography and the anthropology and the history laid out in front of them. So, you know, I'm taking a kind of aggressive stance with you. I agree with everything you're saying, and but I'm interrupting you just so I'm trying to teach through opposition. That's what I'm trying to do here. I'm not, you know, trying to argue with you. I think we both agree, you know?
Yeah, and all I'm stating is that I am I have this academic hat and the Israeli hat, mm-hmm. and it's important to keep that in mind.
Right.
So you're speaking, it's almost as if you'd be speaking from, if this was the 60s and we were in the South, right? You'd be speaking about the travails of the African Americans, of the Black community, to a well-intentioned white guy.
Mm-hmm.
And you'd be asking, so what do the Blacks want? So right. Understand. So you're asking me, what do the Palestinians want? What's best for them? These are questions that, on a philosophical level, it's hard for me to answer.
Yeah. I just want to explain my method here. It's adversarial in order to arrive at the truth. This is what we do in a courtroom. There's the defense and the prosecution. There's the judge and the jury. And the only way to arrive at the truth is to ask a series of questions in a rude way and bottom line things so that the listeners, the jury, can make up their own mind. That's why I take this tone with you. I agree with everything you're saying.
Yeah.
You say Yasser Arafat recognized the right of Israel to exist, but he didn't. Right? I mean, he really didn't. There were certain things he couldn't do, and there were certain things he said. For example, he's been caught on tape. He's dead now, but he was caught saying to his own people, it belongs to us, the entire country belongs to us, not the Jews. He said at the Camp David meetings in 2000 with Bill Clinton, I cannot create a two-state solution. I cannot do this. I will be killed. There has to be one state, and it belongs to my people. He said that to Bill Clinton. Didn't he?
I doubt that it was that clear cut.
He said, if I go home, he and Ehud Barak.
Right, right, right. I know that aspect, but you have to. Israel, if you're talking about, let's take another look at the Camp David Accords, which failed miserably. Definitely the Oslo Accords, they were heading into the direction.
Again, now you're even losing me. The Camp David Accord, what did Bill Clinton in his last few months in office almost achieve, and what were those called?
So the thing that was on the table was, let's say, 97% of the occupied territories would be given to the Palestinians.
Yeah.
So it seems like a good deal, right?
Going to share Jerusalem.
Partially, right? I mean, when you talk about Jerusalem, there's this one part where the Dome of the Rock is, where the Haram al-Sharif, the Al-Aqsa Mosque, that compound, that is something that a Palestinian leader couldn't give up. And that's what they were asking them for. Now, you might say that a Jewish, the Israeli prime minister can never give that up. So some sort of creative solution will need to be found there if there ever is going to be.
Now, here's a question for my historian. Yasser Arafat said something that was shocking, but it may be true. But the fact that he said it and believes it upset the Israelis. He said of the Dome of the Rock, all three Abrahamic religions are linked to the Dome of the Rock. Mm-hmm. But there is no archaeological evidence. This is what Yasser Arafat said. There is no archaeological evidence to suggest that the Dome of the Rock belongs to the Jews. True or false?
I don't know if he said that.
He did say that.
Okay.
It's probably false. Oh, no. As I understood it, the dirty dark secret is that there is no archaeological evidence.
I think there's a consensus that there was a place of worship, the temple, the great temple, located there. That's where the Jews built it, destroyed by the Romans. There was one, and there was another one. I think you really can't.
How much archaeological evidence exists to prove the Old Testament?
Depending on which chapters, but this is beyond. These are not the debates that I am an expert on. But it's very little. Parts of it, but some other parts, other parts do enter human history. Some of it is mythology and some of it is human history. I mean, there was a political entity called Judea. There was a political entity called the Israel Kingdom. They fought different kingdoms in the region. They were subsumed by them. They integrated Hellenism, conquest. You know, it's part of human history that has some sort of archaeological remnants. It's not necessarily a testament. It doesn't follow to the T, the Bible, but to say that there is no ancient Hebrew, Jewish, Judaic, Jehovah connection to between that area of the world and current Jewry is kind of ridiculous. And I know that some Palestinians maybe dabble in that or try to marginalize that. It's not even that important a debate for me. My connection to that part of the land has to do with being born there. It's kind of a futile back and forth. And each time someone finds a ring from, you know, 2,300 years ago, there's this huge excitement and you know, proof. Haha.
Mm-hmm. All right, we have to wrap it up. You'll come back?
I would. Yeah, not a lot of. We didn't spend enough time on the nationality law.
Well, you listen. It's
it's a work in process.
I'm going to give you the last word. This is my solution to Israel.
Right.
The solution is it's like marriage. You got to stay in counseling. You got to, even if you think you're happily married, go to a counselor and keep talking. And, you know, you're married for 60 years and you're still in therapy. You say to the therapist, what's going on? We've been in therapy for 60 years. We haven't accomplished anything. Well, it's all about talking. And I think this is what I think the solution to Israel is. I think the Palestinians and the Israelis need to just keep talking, and get nowhere. And then the people who keep talking eventually die, and their children keep talking, and they start shtupping each other. The solution Palestinians and Jews make babies.
Oh, I couldn't agree more. Oh, yeah. This is, and you've done a good job. Yeah, that's a lot of, I don't want to offend anyone, but that's a lot of how a lot of settler nations consolidate.
Yeah. Instead of Palestinians blowing themselves up in Israel, they should just be blowing Israelis. And I think instead of sending rockets into Gaza, we should be having dating apps, and Israeli soldiers should be sleeping with Palestinian women and men. I forgot that. Yes, it should just be a lot of sex. If there was more shtupping and less fighting, condom free sex, unprotected sex.
And this kind of law is a barrier to the trajectory.
Yeah, I think you and me, I'm older than you, but we need to die. And I think the younger kids coming up need to stop fighting and start loving.
Tell me about it. I got three boys. I'm terrified.
Sex. That's the solution to Israel. More sex, less fighting.
In a strange way, David, you're 100% correct.
In that case, I must disagree with you, because whenever two Jews are talking, I must take. How dare you say that I'm correct? You don't know anything. You putz. Hey, this was fun. Thank you so much.
Wait, let me. You said you'd give me the last word.
I want to give you your handle, your Twitter handle.
Oh, please follow me at Arnon Deg. But also, I just want to say that it's not a zero-sum game, which is not far from what you're saying about the shtupin. There's ways for this thing to go forward where everybody wins. It's not necessarily one empowering the other. And if you'd like to have me again,
I will have you again. And I think we can both agree that with Jared Kushner in charge, only good things can happen.
Of course. Yes. What can go wrong?
What could go wrong? Stay on the line for 1 second. If you're enjoying today's show, please share it on Facebook, Twitter, StumbleUpon, Dig, Reddit. Copy and paste the link to this show and share it with all your friends via email. Spread the laughs, spread the knowledge, spread the love.